Math 40S applied vectors, the component method. And of course, they use this a lot in physics. And of course, you'll use this in conjunction with your notes and assignments. This is just one of the several assignments we did in this. Next slide. So there's the steps for the component method. Just read that or pause. I'll give you about 6 seconds here. The basic idea is you take your vector and you resolve it into x bits and y bits, or up bits and right bits, or lefties and, or correction, easties and northies. You break it into ups and rights or something, right? So you'll see some websites call it resolving your vector. So you're going to take perhaps that A vector there, and you're going to see how much it goes to the right and break it into how much it goes to the right like that. Or you could take it and figure out how much it goes up or how much it goes down. So you break it into upsy, downsies, and rightsy, leftsies. There you go. And then all you do is you add up the upsy, downsies, and add up the rightsy, leftsies, and then it makes one big triangle and of a big upsy, downsy, or a big lefty, righty. And then you figure out that big triangle. Pretty complicated, eh? So you're just breaking vectors into lefty, rightsies, and upsy, downsies, which we'll call X's and Y's, right? Just to be really mathematically correct. So continue animating here. So we're going to break like an A vector will get broken into its X component and its Y component. So you could say that when you went this direction, you actually, and that strength, you actually went that far to the right at that strength and that far up with that strength. And on the B vector here, you could say that B vector, that strength in that direction was the same as going B completely to the right and then B component Y going straight down. So you broke it into X components going X direction and Y components going in the upsy downsy direction. In this case, it's a negative direction. So we'll call down negative. You'll get the idea here. And then what you end up with is one giant triangle from adding up all the X's and then adding up all the Y's, and you can calculate the big triangle. So you're just taking your individual triangles, breaking them into lefty righties and upsy downsies, and adding them all together to come up with a big triangle. Sounds complicated, eh? Let's just do it. All right, there's another example of how it's done. Read the notes. Pause it if you have to. Another 10 seconds here. Next slide. So let's do an example here. So like I said, we're going to break all our vectors into rightsies, which we call X's, and upsies, which we call Y's. And to tell you the truth, what you call your upsies and your rightsies doesn't really matter. In this case, we'll make all your upsies north and all your rightsies east. However, you can pick your upsies and rightsies whichever direction you want. Sometimes it's smarter to do that. In any event, let's just do it this way. There's the example, an aircraft heading straight north and a wind blowing from 270, so it's going to the east. Don't forget, sometimes winds are bass backwards there. They say where they're from, not where they're going. So there's a pretty picture, and I didn't do this to scale. If you wanted to do this to scale with rulers and protractors, go get some grid paper into it. I don't do that sort of stuff anymore. I gave that up. All right, so let's see. I label that, let's call it A vector for airplane and W vector for wind. Pretty imaginative, eh? Now let's break the A vector into its lefty-righty bits. All right, so look, the airplane's going straight up. It doesn't have any lefty-righty bits. It's got no X component. It's just all straight up, so there's zero component. How about the wind? Well, the wind is all right, isn't it? It's going all X. And it's going all positive to the right. It's got no uppy-downy part. It's only got full right. So guess what? When you add up all the X components of each of the vectors, it ends up being 80. Let's find the y components of the vectors. All right, what's the y component of the airplane vector? Well, the y component of the airplane vector, so the a subscript y, is, well, guess what? The airplane's going all up. It's not going any left and right. It's not going anything in the x direction. So we just say ay is 300. And what's the wind doing up and down wise? Well, the wind isn't going in the y direction. It's going all in the x direction. The wind's fully x. There's no y component to it. It doesn't lean any direction towards the y. So it's a zero component. Add up those components. So this is a pretty simple example. Would have been easier just to use Pythagoras, right? Well, if it ends up, you'll end up doing Pythagoras, all right? So it ends up that your resultant x, there's your resultant. So it turns out the resultant ends up going 80 to the right and 300 up. Well, pretty simple, right? On a 90 degree corner. Did we have to get all fancy there? So it just ends up being Pythagoras. Now this was a simple example, of course. It just so happened that one of the motions was all up and one of the motions was all right. Or one of the motions was all in the y direction and one of the motions was all in the x direction. So pretty trivial, actually. So this should look familiar. All right, so the speed was obviously 310, and why did I put degrees there? Obviously, that's not a degree, right? There's no degree on the speed. So 310 kilometers an hour. That should have been kilometers an hour. Per hour. At 039 degrees off of north, which is 039. So there you go, next slide. Okay, let's try one of these. This is one of your handouts. So we'll let your reader there for a bit. You can pause it if you want. And we'll carry on. So when Colleen walks from A to B, and then she walks from B to C. So I drew the vectors. How many blocks does she go when she goes from A to B? How many blocks east? Well, count them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. She went 5 blocks east. How many blocks east did she go when she went from B to C? Well, count them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I put some dots there. Right? What was the total number of dots she moved? How much easterly did she move when she went from A to C? Well, count along the bottom there, the red dots. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Gee, funny. She went 5 and 7 is 12. Let's count her upsies going up. How much north did she go? Let's see. 1, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And how much up did she go when she went from B to C? Well, she didn't go up. She went south. So that's negative 2. So she went up negative 2, which means down. So what was the total number of blocks she walked north when she went from A to C? Well, let's see. Let's put some dots in there. We're checking out this from A to C. So we want to know how high she went when she went from Portage Avenue up to Higgins there. So it looks like 1, 2, 3, 4, about 5. 2, 3, 4, 5. All right, so she went 5 blocks north. So we call this the component method. We just broke those vectors down into easties and northies, or what we call x's and y's. X and y's. And, of course, then once you do that, of course, you can just use Pythagoras because you know that the big triangle, the resultant, goes from there to there. And you knew it was 12 across the bottom and 5 along there, so the resultant has to be 13. That should be rather familiar. So all you did was you turned it into one big triangle by adding up the easties, northies, and then you're back into your inverse tangent function and all that stuff there. Right, so you find the inverse tangent of the inside angle of the triangle, and then once you got an angle or two, you're laughing. All right, so you just turn it into a nice 90 degree triangle, and this is called the component method. So you know how to graph things. Yeah, there's the idea behind it. And I like it when you give me the final answer in a nice big box so I can see what the heck is going on. So tell me it's 13 units at 067 degrees bearing. So now you know how to graph things by graphing, you know, with a scale and drawing, and scale, ruler, and protractor. So that's the geometry method, or the drawing method. You know how to do them with a little bit of simple trigonometry if there's a square corner. You know how to do them using the sine and cosine law when there is no square angle in the triangle. And now you know how to do it with the component method. So there's four ways of doing it. By the way, you can take these components and turn them into matrices. But we shan't cover matrices bits of this. It's the same next slide. Alright, so let's we did that one. Okay, so there's the resultant of that. Let's try one here, do an example. So I'll read the problem there, and this should look familiar. I think we've done this or similar ones several times using other methods. So of course all we're going to do is break this triangle into x's and y's. So we're going to break the two vectors into x's and y's and make one big triangle and figure out that for the resultant and make that and calculate that big triangle, which will have the resultant on its hypotenuse. So I'm not going to do it to scale, so don't get out your protractor or anything. I'm just going to wing them in there approximately. Here's 120 degrees right there. So that's the boat. Going to 25, so we'll call that 120 degrees, 25 knots, miles per hour, you guys call it, 8 at an angle of 0, 1, 0, and yeah, knots isn't quite the same thing because a nautical mile is not the same as your miles, but anyway, so let's call it B for boat vector and C for current vector, so I've got them all drawn in there, and we want to find the resultant using the component method. So let's see, let's calculate the lefty righties, in other words, the x component of the b vector. So we're going to calculate how much that vector went to the right, how much it went along the x-axis. Okay, so look, watch the yellow dots there, it went that far to the right. That looks like an adjacent side of a triangle there, doesn't it? That would be a cosine. Adjacent side of that triangle, so it would be the cosine of that 30 degree angle, 25 times the cosine. Yep, looks like 21.6. Let's find the y part of that. Well, gee, the y part's going to be the sine, right? No other choice. The cosine got you the adjacent, the sine got you the up and down, right there, that yellow bit. So 25 sine 30 is going to be 12.5, obviously. Sweet, so we have resolved vector B. We have resolved vector B into a 21.65 in the x direction and a 12.5 in the y direction. And those are perpendicular vectors. There we go. Okay, well, let's figure out what C is. Let's resolve it. Okay, so we want to break it into its lefty righties and its uppy downies. So there's its left. Well, gee, that looks like the opposite to the 10 degree angle that we know. So that would be opposite hypotenuse. Opposite hypotenuse. Oh, opposite would be sine. There you go. So you're going to do 8 times the sine of 10 degrees. That'll be the lefty right, the x part, that is, of the C vector, of the current vector. And we want to do the uppy downy. So we want to do the up part of the y vector of the current. Oh, and that just reminded me, check this out, I put a big star here and I snuck this in, but when we calculated the by, the y component of the b vector, notice it was negative. It was going in the negative y direction. It was going below y. So I snuck in this negative sign just now, all right? I always forget to do that. I mean, usually you'll pick it up when you do the final touch-up, but just to make sure you understand, that was a negative y. Okay, so now this is a positive y because it went up in the positive y direction. How much did it go up? Well, if that was sine, if the x component was sine, then the y component's got to be the other thing, the cosine, so the adjacent side. So it turns out to be that. So let's add up all the lefty-righties together, and let's add up all the upsy-downsies together. Because your resultant x is adding up the b, the x component of the b, and the x component of the c. So if you add those up, it ends up being 23.04. And when you add up when you calculate the y component of the r, all right, so the up and down part of the r right here, you're going to find out that it's the y component of the b and the y component of the c, and it's going to be negative, all right? It's more in the negative direction than anything else. So you'll end up with negative 4.62. And just draw your resultant diagram, all right? There's your resultant right there coming at you. So it's there that way and down 4.62. Now, of course, the down bit doesn't matter because when you square it, it becomes positive anyways. And then you can calculate that. So the r squared is going to be the x component squared plus the y component squared. And the fact that one of them's negative is inconsequential because squaring a negative is a positive anyways. So you're going to end up with the r is square root of all that noise, 23.5-ish. A little bit of rounding in there. Now you got to find the angle. The angle is obviously the inverse tangent of the opposite over the adjacent. So inverse tan of 4.62 divided by 23.04. Make sure your calculator is in degree mode for now. And you'll find out that it's an 11 degree angle south of east. So it's an 11 degree angle south of east, which is really the same as saying 11 south of east is really, well, 90 plus 11, 101 degrees off of north. So a bearing of 101. But you give me any angle, I don't care, as long as it's right. As long as you give me an angle, then you've given me a vector. It doesn't have to be off of north. I prefer it usually. But as long as it's very clear what angle you're talking about, I'm happy. So the resultant is, and I like to see it in one spot on your paper, 23.5 miles per hour at a bearing of 101 degrees on the compass. Sweetie. What if I animate that real quick again? Sometimes just flashing through these is kind of fun. Here we go. Animate. Engage. All right, next slide. Okay, let's just, that last one there, let's do it using the cosine law, just a good review. So the exact same problem, except now we'll use the cosine law. All right, I'm not going to narrate this, I'll just let her run, just so you can see that you end up with exactly, well, pretty much the exact same answer, allowing for a bit of rounding here and there. Engage. Looks like the same magnitude. How about the angle? So now you got to use that sine law, the normal bear baby bear type thing. The angle compared to the side across from it. Well, the sine of the angle compared to the side across from it. A little bit of swaparoonie here, lazy algebra, cross multiplying, making muffins. There you go. And then you're going to end up doing the inverse sine of all that stuff. So that should be old news, this cosine law. How about I just fling it in there for fun? I'm homesick anyways, so nothing else to do. Anyway, next slide. Animate. Okay, let's do another problem. Here's CJ and Rick pulling on a tree stump. I think we've done this a few times. So let's do it again, but this time we'll do the component method. So we're going to break each force into its northy-southy, into its northerlies and its easterlies, into its y's, that is, and into its x's. We're going to figure out how much is going in the y direction and how much each vector is going in the x direction. And then we'll just add up all the y's and add up all the x's, and that'll be the master resultant x's and y's, which we can piece together in one big triangle. And you don't have to have just two vectors, by the way. You can have like 30 vectors if you want. That's what a GPS does. That's the beauty of this method. You can actually combine 30 or 40 vectors if you want. Sine law and cosine law only works for two vectors. But this would work for a 60-sided polygon if you want, not just a triangle. Okay, so I'll just pause her there so you can see what we've done. So notice there was B. Now, you got to do the tail-to-head method. So I took vector B and I had to transfer it up there tail-to-head-wise. Unless you want to do that parallelogram method. All right, so I transferred it. And now you know the red resultant there looks like that. And you're going, sweet. Well, I know that's 100. I know that's 80. Well, I should wait for that 80 to pop in there. And I know since that's an 80-degree angle there, that this inside angle of the triangle has to be 100. Right? That's an 80-degree angle there, isn't it? Because it was 80 back here. There was an 80-degree difference between CJ and Rick's vector. So it's the same 80 outside up there. So the outside angle is 80, so the inside angle is 100. Sometimes people get confused by that. I don't blame them. So a little bit of simple a squared b squared minus ab cosine of the angle, whatever, the cosine law. And you'll end up with r squared is 19,178 to the square root of that is 138 and a bit. Newtons, right? We discussed in another course what the newton was. Don't worry about it. It's like pounds. It's the metric measure of force. It's just like pounds, but smarter. And a little bit of the old ratios here. Sine law on the left there. Swap-a-rooney. Cross-multiplying. Isolate the sine theta so then you can inverse sine it, or arc sine it, so that you can find out what the angle itself is. And you find out that angle theta is 35 degrees, so that inside angle on the bottom left of the triangle is 35, but then if you were to measure it off of north, since that would be 15 off of north, depending on where, just give me any angle, I don't care. So you can tell me that the final resultant is 35 to the left of CJ, or you can say that it's north 15 east, or you can say that it's 015 bearing on the compass. Whichever. Any angle is a good angle as far as I'm concerned. A vector has to have an angle, though, and a magnitude. Next slide. Shall I animate that real super fast there? Let's just animate that quick again so you see it unfolding. And this is the trigonometry method, sine and cosine law. So we'll make it tail to head. We know the outside angle, so now we know the inside angle. Right there is 100. Good. We got a side, and an included angle. Cosine law. Boom. Automatically. And I give you the cosine law there. Oh, I don't give you the cosine law there. You'd have to look it up. And there comes the sine law on the left to calculate the angle. Now that we've already got the resultant magnitude. Bada bing, bada boom, swap Rooney, inverse trigonometric sine, here we go. Boom. And it's kind of nice if you give me the answer in one concise statement, put a big box around it so I don't have to look all over your diagram there. Okay, next slide. Okay, what are we doing here? Well, now we're going to do it with the component method. So we're going to break down the forces into x components and y components. So how much of each vector is resolved along the x direction, and how much of each vector is resolved along the y direction. So how much upsy downsy do we have, and how much lefty righty do we have, if you want to talk about it in a more colloquial sense, I guess, whatever that word is. Next slide. Right, so it's the exact same diagram, but we're just going to break it into its x components right now. So let's look at A. When you break A into its x components, it's going to be that chunk there. So how long is that length? 100 times the sine of 50. Bada-bing. 76.6. And let's calculate the x component of the B vector. All right. Well, guess what? It's going in the opposite direction, so it'll be negative. It's going in the negative x direction. Oh, good. I remember the negative. I always forget that. So the resultant is going to end up having a total resultant. You know, when you allow for the fact that 76 of it's pulling to the right and 40 of it's pulling to the left, the net result for the resultant is going to be that there's a 36 pull to the right. So it's going to look something like that in green. There's going to be 36 pull to the right. Now we got to figure out the upsy downsies part. So let's calculate the y component on there. There comes the y component is that part there on A. And that's going to be the cosine of 50, because look, there's the angle adjacent. And the y component on the B vector is going to be there. That's going to be the cosine of 30 involved. So there's the resultant right there. The resultant is going to be 36.6 to the right in the x direction. And then perpendicular straight up 133.6 in the y direction. So there's what we did. We took all the righties and added them together to get a total right. And we took all the upsy downsy, the upsies, and added them together. And we end up with one big triangle that we solved, that one there. So now we just solve the one triangle. And there's the triangle we're solving. Okay, now we got all the upsy downsies and all the lefty righties, and it's a square corner there, otherwise it wouldn't be xy's. A little bit of Pythagoras works itself in here. So you see, you don't need the cosine law for this. You can just break everything into SOHCAHTOA laws by doing this. And then you'll calculate the angle, inverse tan at 133 over 36, bada bing, bada boom, 75 degrees, and guess what? That bears a remarkable resemblance once we do the final answer to the previous one when we did it with the sine and cosine law. And it should be awful darn close, except for maybe a decimal point in rounding or something. So next slide, finally. And let's do this simple one. Here's Tara swimming across her. I think we've seen this one before, too. But we're going to do it using the component method. So we're going to break it into its xy's, its upsy, downsy, rightsy, leftsies. There's Tara swimming to the left, and there's the current coming at her from 0 to 0. So it's going to 200, just like you label runways, by the way. So let's see. Let's calculate the x component. Well, this is going to be easy. The x component of Tara swimming. Well, her x component is all, her swimming vector is all along the negative x direction, isn't it? She's got no y direction to her swimming. She's not swimming any bit to the top or the bottom. So it's all negative 8. How about the x for the c vector? So what's that chunk right there? How much of that c is going in the x direction? Well, really in the negative x direction, isn't it? How about, let's see, there's the angle there. So what angle is that? We need an angle here to do a SOHCAHTOA, don't we? So it's the cosine of what? Okay, so let's see, that was 20 degrees right there. So that means that's 70 degrees right there. And since those are two opposite angles or alternate angles, remember how when you got two angles, that two straight lines that cross, the angles across from each other are congruent, so that means that's a 70 as well. Sweet, eh? A little bit of geometry when you muck about with that part there. But then once you got it, you're laughing, because then the Y component is just going to be the sine, right? Anyway, you'll find out the total R, the resultant, has a total of 8 plus another 1.36 in the X direction, in the negative X direction, so a total of negative 9.3 to the left. And what's the Y? Well, guess what? She's not. There is no Y component to Tara swimming. And the Y component of the current is, let's see, what's the Y component of the current? Well, let's see, there's the current, and this Y component is the opposite to this angle, so that's going to be a sine. Normally, if you, well, not normally, if you use the cosine on this one, the Y component's got to be the sine, right? You use both of them. And let's do that math. So now we got the, so there you go. So her entire motion consisted of piecing together all her motion to the left and all her motion down. And then you make yourself one master triangle like that, bada bing, bada boom, and then that's all just Pythagoras, crunch out the numbers there. And this agrees with what we did the last time we did this, when we did it using the sine and cosine law. There we go. So there is, I'll just animate that one real quickly again. So that's it, component method. And I backed it up with a bit of sine and cosine law, just so you can compare and make sure that it worked. So I'm just reanimating. So we're finding the total X to the left, so in the negative X direction. A little bit of geometry involved here. Opposite angles are congruent when two lines cross. I would help you with that part on a test if you needed help in figuring out that angle, because this isn't a geometry test. So now we know the total left-right. Now we're calculating the total up-down. Go. So now we can make a total resultant triangle with all the total left rights and all the total up downs. You can do this with like 50 vectors if you wanted. Just find all their left rights and find all their up downs. Nobody says you only have to have two. This method's really good because you can add like lots and lots of vectors together. Anyway, that should complete that. Briefing is complete.